Good evening. It's Tuesday of Holy Week. Welcome again to our time of reflection and prayer and praise as we walk the way of the cross. We may not be able to meet in our church building this evening, but we are together in spirit as we come before God in humility and a readiness to come to him and be inspired again by him in prayer. This evening's psalm is Psalm 22, a psalm which Jesus himself quoted from on the cross. It's a cry of pain and anguish, a cry of someone who knew the worst sort of isolation from God himself. Selected verses from Psalm 22 say, my God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me, so far from my cries of anguish? My God, I cry out by day, but you do not answer. By night, but I find no rest. But I am a worm and not a man, scorned by everyone, despised by the people. All who see me mock me. They hurl insults, shaking their heads. He trusts in the Lord, they say. Let the Lord rescue him. Let him deliver him, since he delights in him. Yet you brought me out of the womb. You made me trust in you, even at my mother's breast. From birth I was cast on you. From my mother's womb you have been my God. Do not be far from me, for trouble is near, and there is no one to help. They divide my clothes among them and cast lots for my garments. But you, O Lord, do not be far from me. You are my strength. Come quickly to help me. Deliver me from the sword, my precious life from the power of the dogs. For he has not despised or scorned the suffering of the afflicted one. He has not hidden his face from him, but he listened to his cry for help. From you comes the theme of my praise in the great assembly. Before those who fear you, I will fulfill my vows. The poor will eat and be satisfied. Those who seek the Lord will praise him. May your hearts live forever. All the ends of the earth will remember and turn back to the Lord, and all the families of the nations will bow down before him. The dominion belongs to the Lord, and he rules over the nations. Posterity will serve him. Future generations will be told about the Lord. They will proclaim his righteousness, declaring to a people yet unborn, he has done it. So those are the words of Psalm 22. As I said, words which the Lord Jesus himself quoted from on the cross. I'm going to go now to our gospel reading, and we're going to read again from Matthew's gospel, from Matthew 26 this evening and tomorrow. Really, we are focusing on what happened in Gethsemane, and tonight's passage really focuses on the role of Judas Iscariot. So I pick it up in Matthew 26. Then one of the 12, the one called Judas Iscariot, went to the chief priest and asks, what are you willing to give me if I deliver him over to you? So they counted out for him 30 pieces of silver. From then on, Judas watched for an opportunity to hand him over. We move on several verses later in the chapter. We're now in Gethsemane. Jesus went with his disciples to a place called Gethsemane. He said to them, sit here while I go over there and pray. He took Peter and the two sons of Zebedee along with him, and he began to be sorrowful and troubled. Then he said to them, my soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me. Going a little further, he fell with his face to the ground and prayed, my Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me, yet not as I will, but as you will. Then he returned to his disciples, and he found them sleeping. Couldn't you keep watch with me for 1 hour? He asked Peter. Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. He went away a second time and prayed, my Father, if it is not possible for this cup to be taken away unless I drink it, may your will be done. When he came back, he again found them sleeping because their eyes were heavy. So he left them and went away once more and prayed the third time, saying the same thing. Then he returned to his disciples and said to them, are you still sleeping and resting? Look, the hour has come, and the Son of Man is delivered into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us go. Here comes my betrayer. While he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. With him was a large crowd, armed with swords and clubs, sent from the chief priests and the elders of the people. Then the betrayer had arranged a signal with them. The one I kiss is the man. Arrest him. Going at once to Jesus, Judas said, "Greetings, Rabbi," and kissed him. Jesus replied, "Do what you came for, friend." If you've ever been let down by somebody, particularly somebody who you expected to be your friend, someone who might have supported you, someone you'd done something for, maybe you'll understand a bit of the pain, the shock, the disappointment that Jesus would have felt. Judas had been one of those close companions who had followed him round, seen at first hand miracles, heard with his own ears the teaching of Jesus. They'd become close. He was part of that special inner circle. And here he is now, handing Jesus over, identifying him to his enemies in order that he could be arrested in the quietness, the darkness of the night. What was it that got into Judas? Was it disappointment that it was not the Messiah that he thought Jesus would be? Perhaps he had a different agenda. Perhaps he was on a different path of what freedom would mean. Or perhaps he was simply motivated by greed. The Gospels say that Judas had been in charge of the money and that he was prone to steal. Maybe it was sheer selfishness. Maybe selfishness, self-centeredness, is simply what was at the heart of Judas. And maybe that's why we understand him. I was a few weeks ago in St. Mark's Primary School up the road at the beginning of Lent, and we were talking about that little word, sin. And we were saying with the youngsters that one way of simply remembering what sin means is the three letters S-I-N. I is in the middle. I am in the middle. I am in the middle of my thinking, my plans, my priorities. I want, I need. Maybe that's really all it was. Judas said, I want what I want. I want money. And he saw an opportunity to get himself 30 pieces of silver, to take the money and to feather his own nest and to say, this is what I'm going to do. This is the important thing for me at this time. And so he hands Jesus over with a kiss. Jesus is betrayed into the hands of those who will lead him to torture and then to crucifixion. The words of the psalm express the pain, not only the physical pain, but the sense of being let down, betrayed, abandoned, that real sense of isolation. In a very small way, we understand something about isolation these last couple of weeks, something perhaps which many of us are not quite experienced before, that prohibition of being able to come close to other people, that old acquaintance, that old familiarity being suddenly taken away. We have that hope. We have a sure hope, as we were talking about on Palm Sunday, a hope that God will change things around. Her Majesty the Queen said, we will see one another again. We will see our families. We will see our friends. We will meet as a church. But for the moment, there's a real sense of separation, a real sense of isolation. What we understand in the cross of Jesus is a principle of exchange. Jesus, part of the Godhead, God himself, becomes man and experiences something for the very first time that he had never experienced before, the effect of sin. What is the effect of evil? The effect of sin is to separate us from God. And on the cross, when Jesus takes our sin, our guilt, he experiences that isolation, that separation from God, his Father. And that's why he echoes the words of Psalm 22. My God, why have you forsaken me? And so Judas acts maybe as a warning to us. Guard your hearts, lest we also give in to selfishness, self-centeredness, to that sense of entitlement, that sense of looking after ourselves above all other things. Jesus, on the other hand, is, a picture of restraint. He submits to the plan. Later in the gospel, he says, don't you realize I have 12 legions. My father has 12 legions of angels on standby if I wanted to call upon them. But he submits to the plan, which is to go to the cross. He set his face towards the cross, and he's going to submit to that. St. Paul, writing in one of his letters, says, "It's no longer I, but Christ who lives in me." That was a song which was featured on our YouTube channel a few days ago. It's no longer I. That's the realization that when we kneel at the cross, as we come to the cross, when we focus on Jesus and see what he went through, how he exchanged that closeness with God to isolation so that we could exchange our isolation from God to being close to him, to sweet, close, eternal friendship and fellowship. Then we say, love so amazing, so divine, demands my soul, my life, my all. We're going to sing that song on Good Friday, but tonight we're going to hear from Eppie, a wonderful song which says, "How deep the Father's love." Before Eppie sings that, we're going to hear very briefly from Tim Hodgson, a member of our church. You may remember that we're trying to make a point this week of praying for church members working in the health services. Tim's going to tell us what he does, and then I'll lead us in prayer.
Hi guys, I'm Tim. I work as a deputy practice manager in a doctor's surgery in Wandsworth. We've had our doors closed for the last 3 weeks, basically to protect staff and patients during the current crisis. But we're still open. We're still going to work. All initial contact with our patients is by telephone or video consultation. And those requiring an urgent GP appointment who aren't symptomatic are seen face-to-face by a GP or a nurse. We now have to wear PPE for all patient contact. That's a mask, apron, gloves, and we've just received a batch of goggles as well. My role has been setting up the IT to deliver video consultations and remote working where it's needed. Assisting the management of the surgery to ensure we're still providing essential NHS services to patients despite the pandemic, including getting everyone their medicines, people that actually really do need to see a doctor. And now we're planning for the surge in cases during the next week or so, working with local pharmacies. I personally have been working with regional planners at the clinical commissioning group, and the coordinators, and I also work as a representative of all the practice managers in Wandsworth with the London-wide Medical Committee, and daily I'm digesting updates, webinars from NHS England, managing key messages to our clinical and non-clinical teams, as well as trying to buy in the stuff that we need, like alcohol gel that's very, very scarce at the moment. The next stage will be to manage the moment when the really ill and vulnerable people are discharged into our community to enable the hospitals to deal with those suffering from coronavirus. So we really would like your prayers for that, because we're really not sure what's going to happen. It's scary going into work each day, leaving my family at home, and the feeling that at the moment this is the calm before the storm. We'd like to pray for all those on the front line dealing with patients with COVID-19, those consultants, doctors, nurses that are giving of themselves every day in these desperate times, knowing that they're dealing with people that have the virus, and trying to protect themselves and then their families when they go home. I'd like you to pray for all GP surgeries, their capacity to manage demand and care for those that are really ill, including the care homes, when someone gets ill there, who cannot get the care they need from the hospital. And I'd like to pray for the front house, the real front house reception team, who are living on the edge thinking that they may be confronted with someone at any time who could pass the virus on to them. And for those surgeries who basically have a depleted workforce, where doctors are off, isolating, nurses, other members of the team, reception staff, but the rest are still coming in and managing patients' healthcare needs, even though it's a skeleton staff. Thank you so much for your prayers, and I pray for all of those around the country that are having to deal with this in these difficult times, and the fact that we still have to keep going to work and leaving our families at home. Thanks.
Let us pray for Tim and for others. Father, we thank you for Tim and his colleagues. Pray that they would be able to work together to respond to the needs of the community in which they're set. We pray for Tim and for all who are working in the health services. May your force be with them. May your spirit be with them. May they delight to bring hope to those who are down, healing to those who are sick. Lord, bring them through this time of darkness. Let your light shine in the darkness. And let all who know and love you, who are serving in the work of health and medical services, know your strength and your resilience. In Jesus' name. Amen. So now we conclude our evening time together with Eppie singing How Deep the Father's Love.
How vast beyond all.